after we took this long sort of holiday or doing our solo stuff, we decided that we'd only come back together if we really wanted to. And it felt like the early days to us. And that's why we got very sort of excited and said, oh, yes, this is going to be great. And out came a whole load of tracks. In fact, I think I seem to remember that we had to choose from something like 30 tracks to get down to this last 10.
What do you do with the 20 tracks left over?
Well, they're still running about. I mean, they're there. In fact, that's where all the rows came in. But, I mean, that's good. So we had to decide. A lot of people had individual tracks that they liked. The one thing I didn't want to do was actually work on all 30 tracks. And, I mean, it's so funny. Paul McCartney happened to be next door. And he sort of had a very similar situation. And he said, literally had about 30 tracks. But he said he'd worked on virtually all of them. And I thought, Michael, that's a very painstaking way of... I'd rather sort of... do a little bit on all of them and then sort of say, OK, we'll just work on these 10. There's some great ideas that we sort of forget, but we always seem to get very bored with certain ideas if they're lying around.
Continuing what Freddie says, you know, we had all these bits and pieces of tracks and some of them were half finished, some of them were just an idea and some of them were nearly finished. And it sort of happened on its own, really. You know, there are some tracks which you always want to get out and work on and so they get finished. And there are some tracks which you think, well, that's great, but I don't really know what to do with it at this moment. So they naturally get sort of left by the wayside. So we actually didn't have an awful lot of decision-making to do. A lot of it just happened. The tracks which are just bursting to get out somehow get out due to sort of public demand within the group.
Do you have favourites on the album?
Well, I suppose everybody does. I think hopefully we pick the tracks that fit together best and complement each other to make a good album.
Why didn't you do all of your new album in your own studio, Montre?
Well, we live in London, I suppose, and it's just...
we wanted to be at home.
It's a lot easier.
For a change.
And also, I think it took a long while to get this far, and I think we get very irritable when we're in one environment. So, I mean, we, in fact, we used about 3 studios, didn't we? And that's a small amount. For us. Normally we go around. Montreux was good, but it lasted a couple of weeks and we came back.
Climbing the walls. Yeah. What about some of your favourite songs? I mean, stuff from your collection or things that you like. John, I believe Veronica is one of your current favourite singles.
I choose that one because it's my wife's name and it's got Paul McCartney playing bass, which is quite nice.
Cool. Was Paul your favourite bassist as you were learning?
No, he's very good. But he wasn't literally my favourite when I was a young lad, no.
Who were some of your bass influences?
Well, I actually used to like Chris Squire when I was quite young. I used to go and see them playing with Yes. And the guy I used to play with, Roy Gallagher, he was quite good. Hugh McCracken.
Oh, yes. He was good, actually. Some of the marquee of break.
Yeah, but lots of different ones. No, Paul was very good as well.
The track Breakthrough on your album starts off as though it's going to be maybe another Bohemian Rhapsody, the big choir and the full sound, and then sort of breaks into punchy drumming. Is it your intention, some of these, to surprise when people are lulled into that false sense, the choir boys have hit you and suddenly in it comes?
It's a prime example of what we were talking about before. I mean, the track Breakthrough sort of stemmed from Roger, really. It's basically his track. But the sort of a cappella vocal bit in front was from somewhere else. And as, like we were saying, we had 30 tracks. That was a little piece that I thought was quite good. And I didn't want it to go amiss, so I just said, oh, well, just put in front of Breakthrough. So it's basically another song, but it seemed to sort of segue quite nicely. So it's just a snippet.
Well, there's been quite a lot of that, because we wanted to distill as much of the ideas that we had into the album. So it has got very compressed in a way. There's quite a few examples of that.
Can't you see? If I could only reach you,
album is very Queen as well. I mean, in the last 2 years, you haven't really allowed too many outside influences from anyone else to come into the album. It's very much a Queen album, isn't it?
I think it would have been very silly if we'd tried to just sort of say, end up sounding like Prince or whatever's happening at the time. We have to stick to our guns and really make an album of the kind that we feel that people wanted from us. Mm. So, no, it's not fashionable, really, and it's not heavily influenced by outside sources. I think it's very us, and it goes right back to our beginnings in many ways.
OK, we'll come back to the album in a moment. Freddie, Montserrat Caballé, you had a great success there. One always got the feeling that although you're enjoying it, you obviously like opera, that you're also having a wonderful laugh inside as you're doing it and thinking, this is outrageous, but I'm enjoying every moment of it.
Quite true, actually. It's like a tidal wave. It's quite ridiculous, wasn't it? I, actually, at that point, I wanted to do something totally different. And I think it snowballed, really, because I really didn't think that she was going to sort of accept my sort of offer, as it were. At first, I actually thought it was only going to be the one track, but she said, let's make an album. And I thought, my God, what am I going to do now? And so I was sort of stuck with it. I thought, you know, you just don't turn the super diva down, you know. But it was such a different thing to do. I'm glad I did it, because, I mean, it's sort of very nerve-wracking, totally different, totally un-rock and roll, and something that really required a lot of discipline. It's a kind of discipline that was totally different to me. I didn't know her way. I didn't know what she was used to. And she's coming from a totally different world. I realised that I was learning so much while I was actually with her. And so I was sort of feeling my way at the same time, as well as sort of trying to understand how she recorded, how she works, what kind of stuff she likes. So, I mean, while I was writing away, I was sort of trying to find my way to make sure that she liked the pieces. And if she didn't like it, she'd tell you.
Mm. So taught her some things, though, didn't you?
Well, yes. I mean, and there was sort of the recording techniques were different. I mean, she was used to just coming in, sort of doing a bit and running off. And I said, no, you don't do that anymore. And she said, well, I'm not used to that. And I said, well, and so I was teaching her that, no, you can sing differently. And it's a different world she comes from.
Barcelona, it was the first time.
So no touring the country with her in a 1,500-weight comma van or anything like that.
And for my dresses, yeah.
Is there anybody else along those lines you think, as a real flyer, I'd like to do something with them?
Well, Aretha Franklin is one. I can still see her as part of my world, but, I mean, with Montserrat, I mean, I just didn't know where to start. It was like a flippant gesture for me to start it off with, and I really thought it would never come to any sort of fruition. And when she accepted, I was dumbfounded. So then I thought, my God, I better put my money where my mouth is. I'd like to see other rock and roll singers try things like that, you know, and see if they can get away with it.
They probably couldn't get away with it, Freddie, but you did.
There you are. I'm wonderful, aren't I?
Yes. The visuals for that, of course, were absolutely stupendous and over the top, as they have been for various Queen videos and things in the past. For the new album, do you have any over-the-top visual ideas? You must do, obviously.
The first video is meant to be very ungimmicky. We want to just be a band out there and be seen as a band again, which we thought was important. So the large spectacle stuff will be absent from the first video we do. We just want to be a band on stage.
You don't know yet. Mallet's doing it.
Mind you, with David Mallet, yeah, what can you say?
Yes,
cast of millions it could turn into.
He's bad.
You're expecting the cavern and you get the Plaston of Concord or something.
we have a strong visual for the cover of the album.
Which is what?
Well, the radio listeners will have a good time.
Yes, I will.
God, would you like to hear your description of the cover?
No, I can't describe it. No, I can't. But it is unusual and different, and you have to buy it to find out.
Talking of rhythms, as we were earlier, On Rain Must Fall is very much a sort of Latin feel, that sort of samba cum funk feel, Roger.
Yes, that's a sort of a bit of a mixture. That's a mishmash, really. There's, it's sort of quite machine-like in some ways, but with sort of African overtones.
Yeah, lots of overdubs on top.
Yeah, there's a lot of sort of percussion I did on top. So there's all sorts of things happening, but they made me take most of it out, of course, to make room for the guitars.
Yes. And the vocals.
And the vocals, yeah.
I can see it in your stars. Life is so exciting, acting so bizarre. Your world is so inviting, playing really cool and looking so mysterious. Honey, your every day is full of sunshine, but into every life a little rain must fall. Surprising.